Four broadcasts on January 26, track one. The early years of the Beatles were often filled with frustration and anger. John Lennon recalls that it was a time when the group was barely able to eke out enough money to pay for guitar strings and blue jeans. A week-long interview with John will begin after this for Clairol Herbal Essence Shampoo and Body Splash. Throughout this week, we will be presenting an exclusive interview with John Lennon, recorded in New York by Elliot Mintz.
There are places I remember all my life.
John Lennon once described the origin of the Beatles this way. It came as a vision. A man appeared on a flaming pie and said unto them, "From this day on, you are Beatles with an A." In fact, they were only one of hundreds of groups to emerge out of the bleak city of Liverpool in the early 60s, imitations of American bands, all competing for jobs in the city's sweaty, dingy nightclubs. Lennon recalls those days as a time of
struggling along, you know, to go Lord knows where. But at the time, it didn't seem any more fun than now. It was just,
it didn't.
You had a job, you didn't have a job. Look, everything, when you look back on it, you realize how good things were, even though at the time you might have thought, well, God, we've got to play 6 hours a night, you know, all we get is $2, and you got to take these pills to keep awake, man, it's not right. It was a long time before we really had a set following of people that always came to see us when we finally said, we'd like to sing one that we wrote that, you know, isn't an American record that you've never heard of, but it's our song that you've never heard of.
And it was when the Beatles began writing and performing their own music, not just imitating American music, that they began attracting attention.
John Lennon will have more to tell about the formative years of the Beatles when this interview with Elliot Mintz continues later. This is Lou Irwin, Earth News Radio, for Clairol Herbal Essence. For broadcast on January 26, track two. John Lennon says that the formative years of the Beatles were often so frustrating that he often thought of calling it quits and disbanding the group. We'll be talking to Lennon after this for Clairol Herbal Essence Shampoo. This week we are presenting a special interview with John Lennon, recorded recently in New York by Elliot Mintz.
Back in the early years, the Beatles seldom sang their own songs. In fact, they began their careers imitating American music. But Paul McCartney and John Lennon were busy writing songs, and under the direction of their manager, the late Brian Epstein, John began slipping some of his own material into the act.
I remember mine was called Hello Little Girl, and it was subsequently recorded by one of Brian Epstein's other groups called The Foremost. And I think Paul did something called Like Dreamers Do, you know, and we sort of sang that to the audience. They still preferred the straight rock, but they were very nice to us.
Hello, little girl, if I see you passing by, I cried. Hello, little girl.
The group began to catch on in the clubs around Liverpool, but John was unsure of what lay ahead. In fact, he wasn't sure that he even wanted to be a Beatle.
We'd made it in Liverpool. We were making good money for those days. I can't remember what it was, maybe a couple of $100 a week, we'd call it. A relative of mine gave me £100 for my birthday, which I'd never seen that much money in my life. Paul and I just cancelled all the engagements and left for Paris. And George was furious because he needed the money to work, you know. But that was another time when the group was in debate as whether it would exist or not.
The group's search for better-paying gigs led them to Hamburg, a city frequented by well-heeled, music-minded Americans. The Beatles were a hit in Hamburg, but a question still plagued John Lennon.
Is this what I want to do, man? You know, I mean, I was always a sort of poet or a painter. I thought, is this it? You know, this sort of nightclubs and seedy sort of scenes, you know, and sort of weird people in the clubs. I mean, it was really sort of, nowadays they call it decadence, but those days it was just in Hamburg, you know, or clubs that groups played at, strip clubs and all the stuff. And I thought hard about, you know, should I continue doing this? But I did.
And after John made that decision, the group went into the studio to record their first album. It took them all of an entire evening.
And when the Beatles finally came to America, they often gave performances that lasted all of 15 minutes. John Lennon will tell all about that when this interview with Elliot Mintz continues tomorrow. This is Lou Irwin, Earth News Radio, for Clairol Herbal Essence. 4, broadcast on January 27th, track 1. Back in the early days, the Beatles often recorded an entire album in a single evening and gave performances in huge stadiums that lasted only 15 minutes. John Lennon will be remembering those times after this for Clairol Herbal Essence Shampoo and Cream Rinse. This week, we are presenting a special interview with John Lennon. It was recorded recently in New York by Elliot Mintz.
Recording an album today is a laborious process, often taking weeks and sometimes months of work in the studio. John Lennon recalls that the Beatles weren't allowed that luxury when they recorded their first album. Well,
the album being done in one evening was just a matter of finances, and the record company would not let us stay longer than one night in the studio. The first album was recorded in a one long 12-hour session, which the last song to be done was a song called Twist and Shout, which nearly killed me. It was the last song after 12 hours of singing and being in a recording studio for the first time in our lives. And I was always bitterly ashamed of it because I sang it better than that, you know. But now it doesn't bother me. You can hear that I'm just some frantic guy, you know, doing his best.
You know you look so good.
The quickness with which they recorded their first album was matched only by the brevity of their American concert performances.
By the time the Beatles hit America, they no longer could play live very well at all, you know. I mean, Hamburg and Liverpool, we've been used to playing 6 or 8 hours a day or something like that, you know. Or at least nobody played less than 2 hours, 2 or 3 hours for any gig, you know. And by the time we got here, we'd got down to playing 20 minutes in an English theatre. Yeah, a whole concert. And so that's why the Beatles were famous for doing 15-minute shows. We could speed it up to 15 minutes, you know. Over in America, you know, 50,000 people would see us, we'd be off in 15. That was our record. So we got our kicks from seeing how fast we could do the whole show. Sometimes, you know, sometimes it still, we still got into the music.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Well, this next song will have to be our last one for this evening. Yes! Oh, yes! You know, sorry, but contrary to public opinion, we've never done any longer than this, so...
As songwriters, Lennon and McCartney saw all their work recorded, either by the Beatles or some other group. But one of the songs written by Lennon was never released.
And you'll hear that never-released Beatles record when this interview with John Lennon continues later. With Elliot Mintz, this is Lou Irwin, Earth News Radio, for Clairol Herbal Essence. For broadcast on January 27th, track 2. One of the strangest records the Beatles ever recorded was never released. You'll be hearing it when our interview this week with John Lennon continues. First this, for Clairol Herbal Essence Shampoo and Body Powder. Throughout this week, Elliot Mintz is bringing us highlights of an interview he recorded in New York recently with John Lennon.
John Lennon and Paul McCartney did not write all their songs together. Each wrote about a quarter of the Lennon-McCartney tunes by himself. But for business and money reasons, all their songs bear the Lennon-McCartney credit. And all those songs were recorded, if not by the Beatles, then by another group. All of those songs except one.
Yeah, except for What's the New Mary Jane, which is something, a sort of funny song, crazy song that I wrote, and that was never recorded. There's only me, George, and Yoko on it, actually. We recorded it when we got back from India. It is around on a bootleg. She looks as Mongolian lamb. Beep, beep. She's coming from Aldebaran. Beep, beep. What a shame Mary Jane had a pain at the party. A real crack song. I always wanted to release it. It never got released.
One engine party maybe. She handling all the ways good content.
This is a bootleg recording of What's the New Mary Jane. The song was never released on a commercial album. There is at least one song that was released that John would rather not think about, and obviously rather not talk about.
When you look back, which one was the turkey? Which was the song that you released?
I said, never tell you.
No, you never told me.
No,
that.
I will never tell it.
1990, will you tell us the one that you disliked the most?
Yeah, 1990, I promised to tell you the one that you and I always talked about, which I wouldn't tell you.
You wouldn't tell me which
one? So embarrassing to me just to think that it's on disc.
It's a long wait until 1990, and so we have checked with reliable sources to determine just which song Lennon is keeping under wraps. Those sources report that It's Only Love is a prime candidate for the honors.
Why should I feel the way I do? It's only love, and that is all.
In our next report, John Lennon will be tackling a more controversial subject in his interview with Elliot Mintz, the breakup of the Beatles. This is Lou Irwin, Earth News Radio, for Clairol Herbal Essence. For broadcast on January 28th, track one. Recently, interviewer Elliot Mintz had dinner in New York with John Lennon and Paul McCartney. Elliot will be talking to Lennon about that dinner after this for Clairol Herbal Essence Shampoo. Recently, interviewer Elliot Mintz visited with John Lennon and Yoko Ono at their apartment in New York. This week, we are presenting highlights of an interview Elliot conducted with the pair at that time.
When I find myself in times of trouble, Mother Mary comes to me, speaking.
By 1969, tensions were mounting within the Beatles, and each member of the group was going through changes. In growing up together, they had grown apart. John Lennon remembers.
It's not that we didn't like each other. I've compared it to a marriage a million times, and I hope it's understandable for people that aren't married, or any relationship. It was a long relationship. It started many, many years before the American public, or the English public for that matter, knew us. Paul and I were together since he was 15, I was 16. And George was whatever. You know, it's a long, long time that the four of us have been together. And what happened was, through boredom and through just the too much of everything, and people were bothering us with business, the whole pressure of it finally got, you know, like people do when they're together, they start picking on each other. You know, it was like, it's because of you, you'd got the tambourine wrong, that my whole life is a misery. You know, it became petty, but the manifestations were on each other because we were the only ones we had.
When the group got together to record Let It Be, the difficulties seemed more apparent. And not only were they recording an album, but they were filming the event as well. To John Lennon, the camera seemed to have magical properties.
Maybe it was the camera of Let It Be, the idea that we were going to try and create something phony. We could see through each other, and therefore we felt uncomfortable, because up till then we really believed intensely in what we were doing and the product we put out, and everything had to be just right, and we believed. Suddenly we didn't believe.
John and Paul suspended not only their partnership, but a friendship of over 15 years as well. The tensions between them resulted in business problems, and only recently have the two started seeing each other on a more friendly basis.
The last time, which was about Christmas 75, it was very good, and we all had a good time, and were glad to see each other.
And though the friendship between John and Paul had warmed considerably, John's distant relationship with his father has not.
John Lennon will be talking about his attempts to find his father when his interview with Elliot Mintz continues later. This is Lou Irwin, Earth News Radio, for Clairol Herbal Essence. For broadcast on January 28th, track two. John Lennon's relationship with his father has always been a turbulent one. He once ordered his father out of his home. Now he would like him to return, but he doesn't know where he is. He'll be talking about that after this for Clairol Herbal Essence Shampoo and Cream Rinse. One of the most interesting highlights of Elliot Mintz's interview with John Lennon concerns Lennon's relationship with his father. We continue our week-long interview with John Lennon with that story.
John Lennon seldom talks about his parents. His mother died when he was young, leaving him in the care of his Aunt Mimi. As for his father...
My father left me when I was a kid. I didn't see him until I made it. And he sort of blackmailed his way into my life through the press. I refused to see him, then I finally let him in. I started supporting him, looking after him. Then I went to therapy and sort of re-remembered how furious I was in the depths of my soul about being left as a child, you know. I mean, I understand people leaving their children because they can't cope, you know, or whatever happens for reasons, but you don't understand when you're feeling your own misery. So I came out of the therapy and told him to get the hell out, you know. And he did get the hell out, and I wish I hadn't, really, because he was, everybody has their problems, including wayward fathers, you know.
You don't realize how much I need you. Love you all the time and never leave you.
It had taken John some time to come to grips with what went on inside his father's head.
I mean, I'm a bit older now, and I understand the pressure of having children or divorces and reasons why people can't cope with their responsibility.
Since softening his attitude, John has tried to locate his father. So far, he has not been successful.
I tried to write to his lawyer, but I didn't get through. I don't really care if I never do get through. You know, I regret it, and if he ever turns up, I will be reasonable again.
While John's search for his father continues, so does the search for the millions of Beatle dollars.
John Lennon will be talking about the invisible Beatle empire. This interview with Elliot Mintz continues tomorrow. This is Lou Irwin, Earth News Radio, for Clairol Herbal Essence. For broadcast on January 29th, track one. You would think that John Lennon and the other Beatles must be some of the richest men in the world. They are rich, but Lennon insists not so rich as people imagine. Lennon will be talking about the invisible Beatle empire after this for Clairol Herbal Essence Shampoo and Body Bath. No group of recording artists has ever been so successful as the Beatles. But the individual Beatles today still must work for a living, as interviewer Elliot Mintz learned when he talked to John Lennon recently.
Although no one can say for sure, it is probable that the four Beatles earned at least $300 million prior to the breakup. And since most of the money goes to the people who write the songs, Lennon and McCartney, you would think that they got to keep all that bread. But for John Lennon, things did not work out that way.
Some of it's still held up in receivership. Some of it's got to us individually. It's any combination of disasters you can think of is what happened to the money, yeah.
No final settlement?
No. The Beatles did make a settlement about certain things, but it didn't solve the whole problem of the invisible Beatle empire.
John's personal share of the invisible Beatle empire was a lot less than one might imagine.
Always managed to hang on to $1 million. You know, that was my idea of being rich, you know, or thereabouts, you know. I don't sit around bemoaning the millions that I could have had. You know, I'm lucky, I'm doing all right, thanks.
You did once tell me, though, that if it ever came around again, you'd be a damn sight more concerned about how the money was handled.
Yeah, but I think I was probably a bit bitter, I don't know. I mean, it's silly saying that. I mean, that's one of the stupid things I've said. If I was that clever about the money, I could not have been what I am, you know.
That's true.
You know, you can't have it both ways.
Yet John is by no means destitute.
I'm healed well enough not to have to bother. Money is not the sort of incentive of my life, you know. I could spend the rest of my life either trying to make more and more and more, because I can milk the fact that I was a Beatle for another 20 years, probably, you know, and still make a considerable amount of money. So I'm not too interested in investments. I don't think you'll find I'm not invested in anything.
Running and running love, I'll give you all I've got to give.
John could make another sizable fortune right now just by rejoining the other three ex-Beatles in a one-night concert.
John Lennon will be discussing the possibility of the Beatles getting back together again when his interview with Elliot Mintz continues later. This is Lou Irwin, Earth News Radio, for Clairol Herbal Essence. For broadcast on January 29th, track two. What would bring the Beatles back together again? Perhaps a closed-circuit television show beamed around the world for charity? Well, John Lennon will be discussing that possibility when our week-long interview with him continues after this for Clairol Herbal Essence Shampoo. What does John Lennon really believe in these days? Well, one thing that interviewer Elliot Mintz learned when he interviewed Lennon recently is that still,
just believe in me.
It is the rock world's most popular and most overworked rumor. It pops up in magazines and is the constant dream of disc jockeys. John Lennon has heard it all before. Will the Beatles get together again? Perhaps for a one-night concert beamed by closed-circuit television all around the world.
That to me is not interesting because it would only be done for more cash. You might have noticed that I haven't performed for cash since the Beatles stopped. I don't particularly like touring. I don't want to play for money. I'll take the money for making a record because it keeps me in the condition to which I'm accustomed.
But I'm not interested in standing on stage and have people give me dollars, you know? And if that was the reason for the Beatles getting together, I'd have to be broke or owe a lot of tax, you know? And then I'd get up and do the bit with the clown's face and run round, you know? Otherwise, it gives me a chill just thinking of it.
In fact, John says he wouldn't consider a live performance even if the proceeds were to go to charity.
Trouble with charities is they're not very charitable, you know? It's much more complicated than you think. I don't know. I mean, it really never enters my head for the four Beatles to play together. It's feasible that we could play in a studio just for the sake of playing with somebody who knows, you know, who's played with you for years, you know. But apart from that, there doesn't seem to be any point to it, you know, unless it was going to, somebody would guarantee it would save the planet Earth, you know, then give me a call.
Dream is over.
For the present time, John Lennon is interested in only one partnership.
And Yoko Ono will join us tomorrow to discuss her first meeting with John Lennon. With Elliot Mintz, this is Lou Irwin, Earth News Radio, for Clairol Herbal Essence. For broadcast on January 30th, track one. In a recent interview on this program, George Harrison claimed that the presence of Yoko Ono and Linda Eastman in the midst of the Beatles contributed to the splitting up of the group. In a moment, Yoko will be talking about how she became involved with John Lennon to begin with. First this, for Clairol Herbal Essence Shampoo and Cream Rinse. Recently, interviewer Elliot Mintz paid a visit to the New York apartment of John Lennon and Yoko Ono. This week, we are presenting highlights of the interview that Elliot conducted.
Around the time of the Let It Be sessions, a new force entered John Lennon's life. She was a Japanese avant-garde artist named Yoko Ono.
Well, I was in a gallery, and it was the opening night of my one-woman show in London. And then suddenly, the owner of the gallery walked in with this guy who looked very nice, charming, handsome. And I was so busy, the first thing that occurred to me then was I thought, oh, if I weren't so busy, I would have an affair with a guy like that, but, you know, that's too much trouble because I'm busy.
One of the things she was busy with was a conceptual artwork made of a white board and nails. Guests at the art gallery paid a small fee to hammer a nail in the board and thus became, in a small way, contributing artists.
He came, he said, may I hammer a nail in? And I said, well, look, then you can pay 5 shillings and then hammer a nail in. And John said, oh, well, then could I hammer a conceptual nail in and pay your conceptual money?
Yoko says she knew that he was interesting and that she would like to have an affair with him, but she still didn't know who he was.
And after he left, it was very brief, mm-hmm. And after he left, one of the students, he said, do you know him? I said, no. He said, I think that's one of the Beatles. I said, you mean Beatles, meaning the, you know, because I've heard of the Beatles, of course, just vaguely, like I've heard of Elvis Presley or something, which is not very much, you know. So I said, Beatles, you mean that pop group or something? He said, yes. I said, oh, I think that's John Lennon. And of course, that name I didn't know. I said, oh, I see. Well, then put him on the mailing list, I said. And that's how it was.
Yoko and John became a celebrated and controversial couple. But most of the controversy and criticism seemed to revolve around Yoko and her feminist views and the constant rumors that she caused the end of the Beatles.
When Elliot Mintz's interview with John and Yoko continues tomorrow, Yoko will be describing how the public reaction to their relationship humiliated her. This is Lou Irwin, Earth News Radio, for Clairol Herbal Essence. For broadcast on January 30th, track two. Yoko Ono says that the public reaction to her relationship with John Lennon humiliated her. It was one of the matters which contributed to their separation a year ago. We'll be talking to Yoko after this for Clairol Herbal Essence Shampoo and Body Splash. Few women are so controversial as Yoko Ono. Both her work as an artist and her views as a feminist have ignited countless arguments. She discussed her activist role recently in an interview with Elliot Mintz.
Yoko Ono was a darling of New York's underground art society when she became involved with John Lennon. Her work as an artist was as fascinating to some as it was bewildering to others. Still, she was regarded as a unique figure within her circle of friends and associates. But then, along came John, and she became at first the second billed half of the team of John and Yoko, and then Mrs. Lennon. It was hard for her to take, she says.
I was a very strong being, not overshadowed by anybody before I met John, and obviously there was a constant threat of being overshadowed by him since I met him, and I had to go through that sort of precarious situation psychologically.
She tried to assert her own independent creativity. Once even wrote a song called Mrs. Lennon.
Mrs. Lennon, oh, Mrs. Lennon. As an artist who's very strong and who's very self-centered in a way and was very proud and everything, I think it was very good for me to go through that period where I was forced to be humble or forced to face the threat of being humiliated.
For 4 years, Yoko Ono endured her secondary role in the relationship with her husband. Publicly, the two of them could agree on feminist issues and even record record albums together. But to most of the world, it was still John and Yoko. The conflict over roles contributed to the separation a year ago. They are back together again, but Yoko has become more philosophical about being regarded as Mrs. Lennon.
Well, it's still the same. In a way, this is a choice that I made. I can see that now, you know. It was a good experience, let's put it that way.
A third party has now entered the relationship. A child born to the couple on John's 35th birthday.
And even having a child becomes a controversial event in the lives of John Lennon and Yoko Ono. More on that when Elliot Mintz continues his interview with John and Yoko tomorrow. This is Lou Irwin, Earth News Radio, for Clairol Herbal Essence. For broadcast on January 31st, Track 1. Everything that John Lennon and Yoko Ono touch seems to turn to controversy, even having a baby. We'll be talking to John and Yoko about their child after this for Clairol Herbal Essence Shampoo. Recently, when interviewer Elliot Mintz visited John Lennon and Yoko Ono in their New York apartment, much of the conversation centered around a new Ono Lennon. Here is Elliot's latest report.
The blessed event in the marriage of John Lennon and Yoko Ono occurred nearly 4 months ago in New York. Blessed it might not have been. An event it most certainly was.
I'm thinking, oh, what's going to happen? I'm not ready yet, you know. It's frightening. Hmm. It is rather, you know.
It's too late. It's too late, you know. We're going upstairs, you know, October the 8th. I'm thinking, oh, Lord, she's going to come on my birthday.
And that is when Sean Ono Lennon did arrive at 2 o'clock in the morning on October 9th, 1975. John Lennon's 35th birthday. And it would appear John and Yoko cannot even have a baby without controversy surrounding the occasion.
A lot of people sent us messages saying, oh, trust you two to do it like a bed event where the baby comes, you know, we did a cesarean and picked the date. We didn't pick the date. The baby picked the date.
Mm.
And it was magic.
It was not the kind of magic that John Lennon had prepared for. He had studied the Le Boyer and Lamaze theories of natural childbirth, and had planned to assist his wife in the delivery room.
And the last minute, they don't let me in because it is cesarean, right? I'm saying, oh, but I want to... No, you can't go in. So I'm stuck on the other side of the wall, like in the movies. And then I hear this cry, and I think, I'm still paralyzed, thinking maybe it's another one next door, you know, because it is a factory. They're producing them like rabbits. You know? But it was, and I was jumping around and swearing at the top of my voice. I was, and they're all looking at me, and I'm swearing and kicking the wall with joy, you know.
Dot, great, you know, he was saying.
Great! And I'm shouting, and all the doctors are looking, nurses are looking at me, you know, as they go about their normal business.
Sean Ono Lennon was barely into the world when family controversies began to swirl up around him.
John Lennon will be talking about his continuing battle to stay in America with his wife and new son when this interview continues tomorrow. Elliot Mintz, this is Lou Irwin, Earth News Radio, for Clairol Herbal Essence. For broadcast on January 31st, track 2. Of all the Beatles, John Lennon is by far the most audacious. He approaches life with daring. Even having a son becomes a cause célèbre. That story, when our week-long interview with John continues, after this, for Clairol Herbal Essence Shampoo and Cream Rinse. On the day that John Lennon reached the middle of the 70 years allotted to most of us, he became a father for the second time. His first child, by his first wife, provoked a small controversy by drawing a picture which he called Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds. His second child, by Yoko Ono, created a stir just by being born. Here is Elliot Mintz with that story.
John Lennon and Yoko Ono seemed comfortable only in the vortex of controversy. Even naming their child took on the aspects of an issue. He was named Sean, the Irish form of John.
Although one tends to think it's a little John because it's a male, it isn't. It's a combination of John and Yoko which produced something completely and entirely separate from us. It is not a little John Lennon or a little Yoko Ono. It's a Sean.
But why an Irish name like Sean for a child whose father was born in England and whose mother was born in Japan?
I've always liked it. I'm always fascinated by the S-E-A-N spelling. And being a little bit of an Anglo-Irish descent, you know? And so I was always reading about Celts and things like that.
But if John Lennon was fascinated by things Irish, his family was not. He was raised by an aunt of proper English stock.
But my father's father was Irish, you know, and that's not too good in England, as you might guess from the news. So I called my auntie, who brought me up, who's pure English. I says, it's a boy, it's a boy. And she says, oh, it's great, it's great. And she's happy and screaming on the other end of the phone. And I say, well, I've got one thing to tell you. What is it? I said, do you want to know what I called him? Oh, yes, yes, yes. I said, it's Sean. She goes, oh, my God, John, don't brand him. And she kept saying that over and over. I said, don't worry, he'll probably be brought up in America or internationally, and it's no harm, you know, but she couldn't believe it.
There are still a few barriers standing in the way of John Lennon being allowed to raise his child in America. The barriers belong to the U.S. Department of Immigration, and contrary to recent news stories, John Lennon's battle with that agency is not yet ended.
Elliot Mintz will be talking to John Lennon about his continuing battle with the U.S. Immigration Service when this interview continues tomorrow. This is Lou Irwin, Earth News Radio, for Clairol Herbal Essence. For broadcast on February 1st, track 1. You say you thought that John Lennon's battle to stay in America was over? Well, according to John himself, it is not. We'll be talking to him after this for Clairol Herbal Essence Shampoo and Body Powder. Throughout this week, we've been presenting an interview with John Lennon, recorded in New York recently by Elliot Mintz.
John Lennon grew up fascinated by things American. He was nourished on a steady diet of Marlon Brando movies, rock music, and free verse. He wore blue jeans and T-shirts and sometimes liked to affect an American accent. He fantasized about someday living in America. In fact, he took up residence in New York at about the time of the breakup of the Beatles. 2 years later, he was ordered deported. The official reason was that he was a convicted felon, having once been found guilty in his own country of possession of marijuana. But says John,
my name was, through whatever fate, as Dylan said, a simple twist of fate, got my name on the list of lists. You know, and so my name went in some kind of computer, whether it's human or otherwise, and ever since this machine has been sort of continually trying to bonk me on the head, but it keeps missing because it is a machine, you know.
The machine seemed to grind to a halt last October when a federal appeals court overturned Lennon's deportation order. The decision came at about the same time that Yoko Ono was giving birth to the couple's first child, and John was celebrating his 35th birthday. The decision seemed to be additional reason for celebrating, but as John notes, his duel with the Department of Immigration is not quite over.
It's almost as if we're right back into 1971, and I reapply at the local level for whatever status it is, you know, I've forgotten the words for it, but the green, I call it the green card, sort of covers everything. And we go back to the original judge and the original people on the local New York level, and what the decision came down was that they have been advised virtually by these judges that in the big court, wherever that was, to give it to me. But I haven't got it in my hands yet, ladies and gentlemen, and when I have it in my hands, then I know I've got it.
And in John Lennon's mind, there is obviously still some doubt about whether he will ever be granted permanent residence in America.
If we can live in America, we'd be happy to. If we can't, it's unfortunate. We'll have to go and live somewhere else.
Right. If John Lennon is permitted to remain in America, his life here will probably be far different from the turbulent one he was leading here a year ago.
John Lennon will be talking about his year of drunkenness and bedlam when this interview with Elliot Mintz concludes later. This is Lou Irwin, Earth News Radio, for Clairol Herbal Essence. For broadcast on February 1st, Track 2. John Lennon has few regrets about the low points in his life. To him, all of life is an experience, and growth comes as much out of sadness and madness as it does out of pleasure. He'll be talking about his year of drunken hijinks after this for Clairol Herbal Essence Shampoo. Throughout this week, we've been presenting a series of feature reports on John Lennon, recorded by Elliot Mintz. Here is his final report.
A long and winding road leads to your door.
A year and a half ago, John Lennon, with a little help from his friend Harry Nilsson, destroyed the opening night comeback appearance of the Smothers Brothers at the Troubadour nightclub in Hollywood. A few years earlier, Tommy Smothers was one of those gathered around John and Yoko's bed in Montreal to join in the singing of Give Peace a Chance. The drunken carryings-on of Lennon and Nilsson at the Troubadour destroyed whatever peace existed between them and the Smothers. Says John today,
the Troubadour was one of the great moments of my life, and when they write it in the little silly books of Hollywood that will finally be written, that'll be one of the little events like Errol Flynn bit Frank Sinatra's mother at the party. I mean, it was a great night, actually. And it's unimportant only to the people that think it's important. I mean, there were some good moments. You know?
The event was important to Tommy Smothers, who ended his friendship with Lennon after that night. There were similar events, like drunken shouting arguments with record producer Phil Spector during the taping of Lennon's rock and roll album, which led to Spector's walking out of the sessions. But about a year ago, John latched on again to sanity and reconstructed his relationship with Yoko Ono and began leading a relatively sober and conventional existence. Today, Lennon thinks of that turbulent year as an inevitable experience, and he has few regrets.
Well, actually, a friend called me yesterday, and he's just split with his woman. And I said, although I didn't do it myself, when Yoko and I were apart, she did like a spiritual trip, and his girlfriend is doing a spiritual trip, and he's liable to hit the bottle like I did, you know? And I said, if you can possibly be strong enough, spiritual trip's better, because when we got back together, Yoko's in far better condition than me. You come to the same conclusion. All roads lead to Rome, but it's a hell of a way, you know, crawling around your hands and knees in the middle of the night, you know? I've been through it.
John Lennon has been through a lot. It has been a long and winding road. This is Elliot Mintz.
And this is Lou Irwin, Earth News Radio, for Clairol Herbal Essence.
Before I even ask the first question, do you still get troubled and disturbed or bothered or bored?
Me, Elliot? Troubled, disturbed, bothered, or bored? Don't you know that pop stars are above that? That we live in a cloud of happiness that no one can touch?
In other words, you do get bored talking about...
Exactly.
Fine. It's back now to November of 1963.
It is for you. For me, it's April 1984.
The last time we talked about Beatles and the like,
yes.
All your memories of that experience are now good ones, and you've erased all the stuff that was upsetting you, and now the thing that you just want to keep in mind is that the music was good, and it's done. That's pretty much where we left it, is it?
Good. That must have been when I was getting positive, yeah. I like that. But, of course, I remember the other stuff, too.
So I get a bit absolute in my statements, which sometimes get me into deep water and sometimes into the shallow. But both statements are true, and it suits me fine.
Okay, as we enter 1976, as we are now, when you think back to the days of Beatlemania, these days, are the thoughts good ones for you, or are they stuff? Are they things that you rather not think about?
No, I don't have any preference, you know. If Beatle life is brought to my attention, I think about it, or if it drifts into my head, I don't have any. I can't answer the question. You know? I mean, if it depends which thought, where I am, who brings it up, what angle.
Okay, I guess the best angle was at the very, very beginning for you. I just have a feeling that before the whole world got wind of what the Beatles were all about, you were probably writing your best songs, having the best times, enjoying the shows. It's that era that I'd like to talk about for beginning. London, Hamburg, Liverpool, yeah.
Hamburg.
The roots.
Hamburg is a hat, Elliot.
Sorry. Hamburg.
Yeah.
When you think back to those times, just tell me some of the thoughts that go through your mind, the images that you see when you think of yourself as being 20, 21, 22 years old.
Definitely weren't writing the best songs then. We were just learning the trade. But performance was good. We were a good live band then. I enjoyed that. We worked and played long hours, which was good at that age when you could get work. And in general, it's pretty pleasant memories of struggling along, you know, to go Lord knows where. But at the time, it didn't seem any more fun than now. It was just, you had a job, you didn't have a job. Look, everything, when you look back on it, you realize how good things were, even though at the time you might have thought, well, God, we got to play 6 hours a night. You know, all we get is $2, and you got to take these pills to keep awake, man. It's not right. You know? But looking back on it, it wasn't too bad at all. And no doubt looking back on this, well, you know, everything looks great through the memory. Somehow, they were all deported, and I was left in Hamburg playing alone with another group of musicians. It was quite a shattering experience to be in a foreign country, Hamburg. We were pretty young, you know. I was 20, I think, 21, something. I was left there on my own. I came home on my own, you know, with no money and just carrying amplifiers and guitars. And I thought, you know, is this what I want to do, man? You know, I mean, I was always a sort of poet or a painter. But I thought, is this it? You know, this sort of nightclubs and seedy sort of scenes, you know, and being deported and sort of weird people in the clubs. I mean, it was really sort of, nowadays they call it decadence, but those days it was just in Hamburg, you know, or clubs that groups played at, strip clubs and all the stuff. And I thought hard about, you know, should I continue doing this? But I did. I got back to England and I didn't tell the others I'd come home for a long time, thinking, is this what I want to do? You know, and then they found out I was home. They were a bit annoyed at me because we could have been working and earning money, but I just really had to think it over.
Do you think you made the right decision?
Every decision is the right decision because it's the only one you make, you know.
Except if you had chosen the other thing, you would have had anonymity with you?
Not necessarily. I might have become famous as a something else, you know. I mean, what I'm saying is I probably would have become something. Maybe I wouldn't have been as famous, or it's all relative, but I would have. I said this a long time ago, and they always confuse it with arrogance. It's not, I was well known in school, you know? I've been well known all my life, right? It's just a matter of degree. Whether I enjoy it and the pros and cons of the rest of it is a different story, but I just happened to be one of those kind of people. We'd made it in Liverpool. We were making good money for those days. I can't remember what it was, maybe a couple of $100 a week, you'd call it. But enough that you had a little extra, you know, you had it in your back pocket. And Paul and I a relative of mine gave me £100 for my birthday, which I'd never seen that much money in my life. Paul and I just cancelled all the engagements and left for Paris. And George was furious because he needed the money to work, you know. But that was another time when the group was in debate as whether it would exist or not.
In the beginning, somebody said, I don't know if it was you or if it was Paul or someone, that the early songs, the ones that appeared on the very first Beatle albums that were released in America, that those songs were sometimes written in 5 or 10 minutes a song, that a whole album could be done in an evening, one take.
True or not true?
Yeah, many songs are written like that still. You know, I mean, if it's purely inspirational, it'll just come whoop. You know, the whole song will be there. Or even if you sit down, you know, I could write 10 songs. I could write 20 tonight, you know. But what good they are or how, you know, what use they are to Man and the Beast, I don't know. You know, there's that crazy guy that keeps claiming he makes 20,000 paintings a night, you know, and he just rubs his finger in the paint and touches the paper. Well, anybody can do that. And the album being done in one evening was just a matter of finances, and the record company would not let us stay longer than one night in the studio. The first album was recorded in a one long 12-hour session, which the last song to be done was a song called Twist and Shout, which nearly killed me. It was the last song after 12 hours of singing and being in a recording studio for the first time in our lives. And I was always bitterly ashamed of it because I sang it better than that, you know. But now it doesn't bother me. You can hear that I'm just some frantic guy, you know, doing his best. But it always, that was done in 12 hours, but that's because they wouldn't spend any more money, you know. It was the nearest thing to trying to capture us live, you know, that before we, you change, you go through all so many changes. That was the nearest thing to as we might have sounded in Hamburg or Liverpool to the audience, only it's still, you don't get that live atmosphere of the crowd stomping on the beat with you and all that, but it's about the nearest it could get to knowing what we sounded like before we became the clever Beatles, you know. It got pretty boring. No, not after the first couple of months, it took years. But I've said this many times, by the time the Beatles hit America, they no longer could play live very well at all, you know. I mean, Hamburg and Liverpool, we'd been used to playing 6 or 8 hours a day or something like that, you know, and or at least nobody played less than 2 hours, 2 or 3 hours for any gig, you know. And by the time we got here, we'd got down to playing 20 minutes in an English theatre, yeah, a whole concert. And so that's why the Beatles were famous for doing 15-minute shows. We could speed it up to 15 minutes, you know. Over in America, you know, 50,000 people at Caesar, we'd be off in 15. That was our record. So we got our kicks from seeing how fast we could do the whole show. Sometimes, you know, sometimes it's still, we still got into the music. We couldn't play the game anymore. We could see through each other, and therefore we felt uncomfortable because up till then we really believed intensely in what we were doing and the product we put out, and everything had to be just right, and we believed. Suddenly we didn't believe. We couldn't do it anymore. It had come to a point where it was no longer creating magic, and the camera sort of being in the room with us made us aware of that, that it was a phony situation, that we'd come to a stage where we would be completely phony, no reality left. And that was the end of it. I trust you to know how many.
I believe there were 318.
318 published.
Yes, 318 published.
Quite a big stack of them that were never published.
Written or recorded?
Written.
But everything that the four of you have recorded, that the two of you wrote, has indeed been released in one way or another.
Yeah, except for What's the New Mary Jane, which is something, a sort of funny song, crazy song that I wrote. And that was never recorded. There's only me, George, and Yoko on it, actually. We recorded it when we got back from India. It is around on a bootleg. What a shame Mary Jane had a pain at the party. A real crack song. I always wanted to release it. It never got released.
The other night you went out and had dinner with...
did I?
Paul and Linda McCartney.
Yes.
What's it like these days when you and Yoko and Paul and Linda get together? What's it like for you when you see your old childhood pal, your chum, your best friend of those very important years of your life? And it's true that over the years you've drifted apart. What's it like on these frequent reunions when Paul drops by?
Well, you were there for one of them, weren't you? And it was pretty pleasant and we had a laugh, you know? You don't have time to get, you know, really deep or anything like that, you know? And it was pretty pleasant. You know? Sometimes it isn't so pleasant. Sometimes it just, you know, that bit when old friends come, you know, depends what mood you're in. The last time, which was about 2 weeks ago, Christmas 75, it was very good and we all had a good time and were glad to see each other. I can't say anything else.
Do you miss the innocence of the time that the two of you spent together before fame and fortune? No?
I don't miss anything, you know. I have a few regrets, and not many, you know.
I asked Yoko that question just an hour ago about some of the things in her life that she's regretted. Before giving you her answer, tell me about some of the things in your life that you've personally regretted having done.
I think I could have had a better relationship with her ex-husband and the child. I think partly a lot of the reason we can't find them is I could have dealt with it better and less childishly myself. And I feel responsible, although it's not only my responsibility. And slightly the same thing with my father. So, apart from that, I don't regret. I regret hurting people or anybody in general, but that's too bad. You know, you can't go through life without treading on ants or even bumping into elephants, you know. My father left me when I was a kid. I didn't see him until I made it. And he sort of blackmailed his way into my life through the press. And then I refused to see him, then I finally let him in. I started supporting him, looking after him. Then I went to therapy and sort of re-remembered how furious I was in the depths of my soul about being left as a child, you know. I mean, I understand people leaving their children because they can't cope, you know, or whatever happens for reasons, but you don't understand when you're feeling your own misery. So I came out of the therapy and told him to get the hell out, you know. And he did get the hell out, and I wish I hadn't really, because he was, you know, everybody has their problems, including wayward fathers, you know. I mean, I'm a bit older now, and I understand the pressure of having children or divorces and reasons why people can't cope with their responsibility. I tried to write to his lawyer, but I didn't get through. I don't really care if I never do get through. You know, I regret it, and if he ever turns up, I will be reasonable again. But those only two things, you know. I'd like to clear them up before I die, and maybe, you know, that's about all. The Troubadour was one of the great moments of my life, and when they write it in the little silly books of Hollywood that'll finally be written, that'll be one of the little events like Errol Flynn bit Frank Sinatra's mother at the party. I mean, it was a great night, actually. And it's unimportant only to the people that think it's important. I mean, there were some good moments, you know. And it's just that a friend called me yesterday, and he's just split with his woman. And I said, although I didn't do it myself, when Yoko and I were apart, she did like a spiritual trip. And his girlfriend is doing a spiritual trip. And he's liable to hit the bottle like I did, you know? And I said, if you can possibly be strong enough, spiritual trip's better, because when we got back together, Yoko's in far better condition than me. You come to the same conclusion. All roads lead to Rome, but it's a hell of a way, you know, crawling around your hands and knees in the middle of the night, you know. And so that was the advice I gave him, and he called yesterday, and I hope he takes it. He probably won't. He'll probably have to go the hard way, because he's male, you know, and we express ourselves in those ways and violence and all that. And that's how I feel about it. I've been through it. It's unimportant. It's over.
You really went through it. I mean, it became almost legendary. The past year with the drinking, with the Spectre session, with Harry Nielsen, it just goes on and on forever and ever. Do you look back
at... I just wanted to show the boys that if they want to know how to get really down with it, I can get further. You know, I'm an extremist, right?
But you bounce...
I mean, if they want to play Hard Knocks, we go right through the wall, you see.
Could you recall...
Macho crap.
Could you recall, like, a composite picture of an evening during that you could reveal to the people that would give them an idea of what it was like when you were down and out in Hollywood 1975?
I wasn't down and out, Elliot. I was down and up. No, I couldn't do that. I mean, look, I mean, we had the same kind of nights in Liverpool before we ever made it. It's just that when you're famous, they put you in the paper when you tie one on, as you call it. You know, you get in the paper when you're famous, and you're not, if you're just some guy in Idaho goes out with the boys and, you know, breaks a few telephone booths or something, nobody writes about it. You either get arrested or you don't, you know. It's exactly the same as anybody else does it, only we do it with red carpets in front of us.
You ever get bored of all of this stuff? I mean, of being John Lennon, of being John and Yoko, the constant attention, the fame, the accoutrements that it causes. You ever just wish you could be anonymous, put the ski mask over your head, blend into the crowd,
and act independently from everybody else without the whole world being interested in your business, without people like me prying and turning up these things, asking questions. Would it be good if all of this was just not there?
I don't know, you know. I mean, I do get bored with it or frustrated with being the famous one or one of the famous ones. But then I did it myself, you know. I can't blame anybody else for the situation. I mean, I did it, you know. And I vaguely remember not being famous, as it were. And it was no easier or harder, actually.
It wasn't?
Not much, you know. Sometimes I'd like to be invisible, you know. But maybe I don't try hard enough.
Try harder at being invisible?
Yeah. You know, maybe in the back I'm really still, you know, like the glamour. You know, I do enjoy being famous, too. Sometimes it's great, you know, whoopee, you know. Other times it's a pain in the neck, but I guess everybody's life is like that, you know. That's what I keep saying, there's no secret. You know, it doesn't, you know, the only, you know, if you haven't got any food and you're starving or you're ill and you can't pay for the doctor, then it's bad. But anything above that, one car or 12, it's pretty much the same.
The last question is always the same question as it is whenever we end an interview or a discussion about Beatle business. And when I last spoke with you on film and television, I asked you, what do you think the chances would ever be of the reunion? And you said to me, I really couldn't say. And then I said to you, what if you really could say? And then you said, I don't know. And I said, but if you did know, and you said, quote, I don't know, Elliot. It doesn't make that much difference to me, but the wounds have all been healed, and if somebody called me up and said, let's do it again, maybe I do it again. The most important thing is that we just go ahead and make music, unquote. January 1st, 1976. Would you like not to go on tour, not to be the Beatles again, not to make records and lunchboxes and craziness, but how about one glorious night, the big reunion, the closed-circuit reunion in every movie theater in the world, the Beatles back again?
There's obviously people have talked about that. That to me is not interesting because it would only be done for more cash. You might have noticed that I haven't performed for cash since the Beatles stopped. I don't particularly like touring. I don't want to play for money. I'll take the money for making a record because it keeps me in the condition to which I'm accustomed. But I'm not interested in standing on stage and have people give me dollars, you know? And if that was the reason for the Beatles getting together, I'd have to be broke or owe a lot of tax, you know? And then I'd get up and do the bit with the clown's face and run round, you know? Otherwise, it gives me a chill just thinking of it.
Let me approach you from a different door.
Come in, my dear.
What if it was the four reunited for one night for benefit, for $10 million going to some charity or some organization or a concern?
Trouble with charities is they're not very charitable, you know. It's much more complicated than you think. I don't know. I mean, it really never enters my head for the four Beatles to play together. And like I said in that interview to you, it's feasible that we could play in a studio just for the sake of playing with somebody who knows, you know, who's played with you for years, you know. But apart from that, there doesn't seem to be any point to it, you know, unless it was going to, somebody would guarantee it would save the planet Earth, you know, then give me a call.
Got to do one more follow-up question on this because it's the one that...
When the Martians get in touch with us, then the Beatles will do a concert.
Right, forget about the concert for a minute. What if one of...
But cancel that. It might happen. Yeah, Happy New Year, everyone, wherever you may be.
And now, if we could just have a verse so this time goes by.
You must remember this. A kiss is just a kiss. A fly is just a fly.
Will make this different from all the interviews we've done before because he was not around. No, he wasn't. So I'm going to start with Yoko, and I want you to just talk, if you may, about birth, childbearing, pregnancy, the moment you knew that it was going to be a boy, le boye, wherever your mind takes you on that. I'd like you to just talk extemporaneously, okay?
Oh, it's great that it happened, you know, and when it happened, I mean, that I realized that I'm pregnant. I was a bit scared again. I mean, the old me came back, you know. And in the old days, I used to, if I get pregnant, it was always very inconvenient, you know, because I always felt that I'm going to be trapped by the fact that I have a child, was sort of always inconvenient for my work and all that. But then suddenly I discovered I was different about that. It's all right to have a child, you know. It's not going to be inconvenient. It's not going to destroy my work or whatever.
And all these questions, by the way, are to either of you, so whenever I say something that moves you, just hop in.
Oh, you mean... Oh.
Yeah, you too. Did you have a preference, either of you, male or female?
We were hoping for a bisexual.
No, no.
No, you weren't.
No.
Did you have a preference?
Yes, remember.
Well, I was sort of hoping for a little girl in a way. But I don't know whether I was hoping for a little girl because I didn't want to hope for a little boy, or going through all the woman's liberation, you know, macho, and I don't know what I felt actually about it. I thought of both and I would have welcomed either.
Same.
Well, yes, in a way, I was hoping for a daughter. Because
I was very glad when it turned out to be a boy anyway, you know what I mean?
Well, John thought, well, either sex, really, you know. We were hoping for a healthy child, you know. We were very anxious to have a healthy child, and of course, you know, we were brainwashed by these people, you know, constantly talking about, well, the 60s flower children, you know, they went through so many things, and it's very difficult for them to have a healthy child, you know, that one. A delicate question.
Turned out to be BS.
Is that legitimate that they instilled fears in you, that because in the past the two of you have used different drugs, that it
there
might
was,
have...
Many doctors in Europe and America gave us a lot of garbage about the way we lived. Also, the fact of Yoko's age. And they instill so much fear in you, you don't ever think you could possibly have a child, do you? And then you start to realize, oh, yes, now if I did this to myself in 1965, but for the last 2 years I've done this, I've probably repaired any damage. We're a living, growing organism, you know. I mean, a tree can be down to its last legs if you forget, in the house, a plant, you know, you forget to look after it for a bit. And then you can save it with a glass of water, you know, and bring a little touch of brandy even, and it'll come back, and you can, so, you know. And they always put that fear around about LSD, which is all untrue, and marijuana. You know, they're still putting it around that LSD, you'll jump out the window. You'll jump out the window if you're in the army, and the army give it you without telling you, you know, and they drive you crazy, you know.
We should quickly insert that perhaps the final chapter on the subject of LSD and its impact upon social action has not yet been written, and I'm sure we're all open-minded to whatever new information comes down.
We are definitely open-minded about it, especially window pane.
Well, I didn't think it was right to take LSD while I was pregnant.
No, that's
true.
I mean,
that kind of thing. I mean, I was very careful. I took nothing that I thought would be damaging for the baby. I didn't even drink coffee, that's what I mean, you know.
We gave up smoking, in fact.
Right, we gave up smoking. And somehow I felt that it was a seed that's going to grow, and it's just a beautiful feeling I had, you know. And I never had that kind of feeling about childbirth before.
During the 9 months that you were carrying...
18 months.
18 months?
Yes, it was a long time.
Yeah, during the year and a half that you were carrying Sean, I mean, you've always been an extremely active woman. All the time I've known you and all the time that I've read about you, you've always been involved in one thing or another and going here and going there. And I guess for that nine-month period when you were... I assume you just never left the apartment.
No. I mean, we took a walk once in a while. Yeah.
Now and then we'd go out for dinner or something was a big event, and we'd go and come back. But we spent most of the time, which is cool with us, actually. We do most of our best work in bed, and we're not being facetious, you know.
So you did, in fact, we're recording this in your New York apartment, and you did, in fact, spend most of that nine-month period here. What did you do during the 9 months?
Well, mostly meditate or get inside yourself, you know.
Meditate?
Meditate, not specially meditate, but meditating in a sense of really getting into yourself, you know. Well,
I don't know, we had fun.
Yes, we were very happy, actually. It was really thrilling, you know, because, we had to be very careful about the diet you used to make this juice from.
Oh, I was making, and we were into what we were eating.
What juice?
sort of a combination that Dick Gregory told us about. I have sort of B complexes and calciums and nuts and things all in the blender. You know, I used to make that every morning, and that'd be our breakfast. And we just concentrated entirely on having the baby because, you know, because they'd scared us. I mean, I'm glad we did it anyway. It's the best way for the baby and the mother, you know. So the whole 9 months was, it's a luxury, but we did it, you know. We were having a baby, and we were conscious of that all the time. Because before, we'd never been conscious of it, you know? I mean, Yoko had been pregnant before, and we just carried on like normal, you know, like going to the, I'm making records, and she's sitting around and bopping or doing events or whatever. And we found out that it doesn't work for us, you know? Yeah, we had to do one thing. We wanted the baby. Having a baby is what we did.
Well, I remember when I had a miscarriage in London, we were making this single called Cold Turkey, and we were producing it and in a record studio. Well, we were working from, say, like 8 at night to 4 in the morning or something every night, and, you know, just forgetting, just ignoring the fact that I'm pregnant. And no wonder we had a miscarriage, you know. And I often thought of that. So, and this time we were very, very careful. And so first of all, I had to sort of think in terms of, am I ready to sit around for 9 months, you know, it's that kind of thing. But then, surprisingly enough, I felt, yes, well, you know, it's not bad to take a year off, you know. And that's how I did it.
What hospital was it?
What was it, New York Hospital.
When did you go in, and tell me about the experience just prior to the time that you went into delivery?
Oh, well, it sort of suddenly started to be a bit different, you know, and I called my doctor, and he said, well, and he called me back at 10 o'clock at night when we were just relaxing, starting to relax, you know, in bed, and he said, well, I'm afraid you have to come to the hospital now because the result of the test was blah, blah, blah. So I said, oh, well.
Couldn't we go tomorrow morning? We asked
him. Right. And then I suddenly started to cry because I was so nervous. I don't know if I want to go to the hospital. I mean, that's another thing about hospitals. Sort of these days, you know, people are not really too sure what hospitals are like, you know. Well, I'm not, at least. So I get very worried about it, too. But anyway, so Joan was consoling me, and we just went to the hospital. And then they had a test, and they found out that, well, probably it has to be cesarean, that kind of thing. And it was all right. But I didn't know when the baby was coming. The doctor was saying, well, we have to wait. At least we should wait until it starts to kick or whatever, you know, the first sign of the movement and everything. So we were waiting, and then around 10 or 11 o'clock at night on October 8th, he started to really move, you know. The contraction started, and I was thinking, oh, what's going to happen? I'm not ready yet, you know. It's frightening. Mm. It is rather, you know.
It's too late. It's too late, you know. We're going upstairs, you know, October the 8th, I'm thinking, oh, Lord, he's going to come on my birthday. They're wheeling us upstairs, and she's saying, I don't think I'm ready. I'm going, yes, you are. Yes, you are. You know, and well, he came at 2 o'clock in the morning.
How nervous?
Right on October the 9th.
How nervous were the two of you?
But for those, for those of you who think we planned it on John's birthday, a lot of people sent us messages saying, oh, trust you two to do it like a bed event where the baby comes, you know, we did a cesarean and picked the date. We didn't pick the date. The baby picked the date. And that's, it was magic.
Right. It was really magical. But we were so nervous, you just don't know how, you know, until he came, you know, remember? After the contraction.
The last minute, not only La Boya, but we'd been to La Mars, which is that's pretty famous, much more famous than La Boya, which is sort of natural childbirth thing. Even though in the back of my mind, I thought it would be cesarean in the end, just to know about it, you know, because I didn't know about it either. We didn't do it that way because we couldn't. Although our doctor was a very, you know, nice guy and aware of all those things. We had a cesarean, which is a bit different. You know? It is an operation rather than just a natural childbirth. And at the last minute, they don't let me in because it is cesarean, right? And I'm saying, God, but I want to... No, you can't go in. So I'm stuck on the other side of the wall, like in the movies. And then I hear this cry, and I think, I'm still paralyzed, thinking maybe it's another one next door, you know, because it is a factory. They're producing them like babies, like rabbits, you know. But it was, and I was jumping around and swearing at the top of my voice. I was, and they're all looking at me, and I'm swearing and kicking the wall with joy, you know.
Doctor Great, you know, he was saying.
Effing great! I'm shouting, and all the doctors are looking, nurses are looking at me, you know, as they go about their normal business.
When did you come out of the anesthesia, and when was the first moment that you were conscious?
What is that?
As the baby, you see, that they only put out the bottom half of her with some new drug, you know.
I didn't see you were conscious.
So she was conscious, and then even for a cesarean. And then they took the baby out, gave her, showed it to Yoko, you know, and Yoko just goes, is that the baby? Good. Take him to John.
And he turned out to be a large baby at birth, didn't he? What was the weight?
We decided to have a large one. We went for a whopper, you know what I mean?
And you got one. I forgot his weight. Do you recall?
9 pounds.
Because he was born in America, 9 pounds 10 he was when he was born.
That's very large.
They said he was a little overweight because of something to do with Yoko's condition. But we think it was better anyway, you know. He had a better chance of surviving if he was a bit heavier.
Okay, now, a few moments after the baby's born, an hour or two after the baby's born...
Another strange thing doctors say to you all through pregnancy is they keep telling the wife, you're gaining too much weight. And then they were going on like this for quite a bit. This is a different doctor we changed midstream, actually. And we suddenly said, well, why? He says, oh, because it's harder to lose afterwards. We said, forget about afterwards, you know. You know, if she wants to eat like a pig, let her eat like a pig. You know, the baby's going to get it. But the whole thing is geared to mother must look slim immediately. She's had the baby. She's got to look like Greta Garbo, you know, and go back to normal life, right? It's incredible.
Well, it's sort of like in now, I understand, that the baby should be small, you know, when it's delivered.
And convenient.
It's more convenient, I suppose, for the doctors, too, because it probably sort of delivered faster, too, you know, and all that. And so it's getting smaller and smaller. 20 years ago, I understand, it was like 9 pounds is nothing, you know, 10 pounds, 11 pounds, baby. But now, 6 pounds is sort of normal, something like that. But you see, in our case, because the baby came 2 weeks earlier, it was better that he was large. I vaguely remember how the baby looked, you know, sort of. But that's all I remember.
And he looked just like his mother, you know.
That's exactly what he said the first time I said it. When the first time John saw the baby, he said, what did he say?
I was telling all the whatever they are, you know, other people, the nurses and the
orderlies,
whatever they are, all in green suits, you know. I said, he looks just like his mother. It's amazing. And they're all going, no, they don't look like any. They all look the same. I'm saying, he looks like his mother, I'm telling you, which he does. He's beautiful.
But his eyes, that's all.
He's got his mother's eyes.
You see, what we wanted, I was vaguely wanting my future with John's sort of, you know, John's sort of a bit narrow here. You know, I think it's very nice, you know, sort of nice oval face he has. So I was thinking, his sort of frame and... my sort of thing, you know.
Well, you got what you wanted, so it was you that did it.
Ah. And then it happened like that. I mean, he has a nice sort of oval face, a bit longer, but, you know, you're a bit longer too, so. And then the colouring is you, isn't it? Definitely. Mm-hmm. And then his eyes are definitely mine. That's how it worked out, didn't it?
Mm-hmm. Beautiful.
The first time when I saw the baby, I was sort of crying and overwhelmed and all that. But anyway, since then, whenever I see the baby, I say, thank you for coming to us, you know. I say, thank you for coming to us. I mean, you're taking a chance. You're very courageous because we're not the most model sort of great parents, probably. But
oh, we're very good.
Well, all right, yes. Well, you know, the first 2 months...
We're just crazy.
Right, just a bit crazy. But it's probably hard for the baby. That we are like this, but well, then, you know, we're not perfect, so
who is?
Right, so in a way, you know, I feel very thankful to the baby. thank you for coming to us, you know.
What do you both recall as being the first things that both of you did, thought of the, within the first few hours after Sean's birth?
Well, Mother was...
Well, I was just...
They knocked her out after out, that, because yeah. then they had to sew her up, you know, and clean up a few messes from a 10-year-old operation, you know, so that they had to knock her out after the baby. You know?
So it was just...
So there was just me and the nurse in this sort of terrible-looking place called the intensive care unit, you know. But I was just all eyes for the baby, and I just sat all night looking at it, saying, wow, it's incredible, wow, you know, just all night, you see? And that's it, you know. And then when I saw her and told her he's fine, you know, because she'd forgotten, she'd been knocked out and everything, and we just cried and had a fun, you know. And we've
we
never looked
back. We couldn't believe it. We just kept saying, it's a miracle, it's a miracle.
The very first name I thought of was Sean. I've always liked it, and I'm always fascinated by the S-E-A-N spelling. And oh, being a little bit of a Anglo-Irish descent, you know, and so I was always reading about Celts and things like that. And it's an Irish name, and it's Irish for John. And I don't like juniors, you know. I know it's very popular in America, but not in Europe
not
so
anymore,
much.
Is it? Not
it's still
anymore.
Pretty popular to have somebody junior, you know, like a replica of yourself, which is
or the second.
The second, yeah, or the third, of the first, which I think is ridiculous, because although one tends to think it's a little John because it's a male, it isn't. It's a combination of John and Yoko which produced something completely and entirely separate from us. It is not a little John Lennon or a little Yoko Ono. It's a Sean. It's itself, you know? He is himself. He's nothing, you know, apart from us giving birth. I called my auntie in England. This is a nice story. It might round it off for us. Okay, because all my family is English except for my father's side. You know, pure, straight English, right? But on my father's father was Irish, you know, and that's not too good in England, as you might guess from the news. But I've always been a bit interested. The name Lennon is Irish, so that's, you know, I'm entitled. So I called my auntie who brought me up, who's pure English. I says, it's a boy, it's a boy. And she says, oh, it's great. And she's happy and screaming on the other end of the phone. And I say, well, I've got one thing to tell you. What is it? I said, do you want to know what I called him? Oh, yes, yes, yes. I said, it's Sean. She goes, oh, my God, John, don't brand him. And she kept saying that over and over. I said, don't worry, he'll probably be brought up in America or internationally, and it's no harm, you know. But she couldn't believe it.
You did, in fact, give birth to Sean on John's birthday, and
fantastic.
And also it was your 35th birthday.
Oh, yeah.
And also it was the day that we were told, anyway, that your problems with the immigration people seemed to indicate that they're over. As yeah. we're recording this tonight, yeah. we should indicate that they are not, in fact, over, but it looked that day as if they were, correct?
Well, it either, there's a very good con game ongoing, or it is virtually over. Because the judges, two out of three judges, came down on my side. And now it's almost as if we're right back into 1971 and I reapply at the local level for whatever status it is, you know, I've forgotten the words for it, but I call it the green card, sort of covers everything. And we go back to the original judge and the original people on the local New York level, local New York immigration, and ask for whatever we ask for. And what the decision came down was that they have been advised virtually by these judges that in the big court, wherever that was, to give it to me. But I haven't got it in my hands yet, ladies and gentlemen, and when I have it in my hands, then I know I've got it. I've said it many, many times. My name was, through whatever fate, as Dylan says, a simple twist of fate, got my name on the list of lists, you know. And so my name went in some kind of computer, whether it's human or otherwise, and ever since, this machine has been sort of continually trying to bonk me on the head, but it keeps missing because it is a machine, you know, even though it's manifest as human beings. It's just my name got on some list, and that's it. It's like when they send like garbage through the mail all the time, you know, and they keep sending the garbage, and I'm finally trying to get through to the source and say, I don't want to buy this. Do you mind stopping? It's a political decision, no matter what the immigration department keep insisting, and everybody knows it. And it's a decision that might be hard for them, because maybe guys that were in power, even though it's the same party in power, you know, once the bureaucracy starts something, it's pretty hard to unwind that red tape. It just keeps churning on out. And who's going to make the decision? And what is Lennon going to do if they suddenly say, okay, is Lennon going to make a noise? Or is somebody, some congressman going to stand up and say, well, what were you doing with him in the first place? If there's time still to bother with rock stars, which is what I am, you know.
Well, it's the new year, and last year we accomplished something great, we feel, and it's like a big achievement. It's probably one of the best things that John and Yoko did, you know.
It was our best event.
Right, best event, right. So we feel sort of uplifted, you know, and we want to start the new year with a nice high note, don't you think?
Yeah, and I think it was the perfect end to an almost perfect year, regardless of immigration. All those things are an irritant, like any lawsuit is, but it's all unimportant. The main thing is we're together, we have a baby, and if we can live in America, we'd be happy to. If we can't, it's unfortunate. We'll have to go and live somewhere else.
Right.
That's all. That's the worst that can happen.
And finally,
Elliot.
I wish you all well. Congratulations on the baby. Thank you for being with us today.
You must remember this.
A kiss is just a kiss.
A fly is just a fly.
Right, and we're together.
A rose is a rose.
With John and Yoko in New York City, Elliot Mintz, Earth News Radio.
This is John Lennon talking to you from the heart of the West Side of New York in an interview, exclusive, a four interview with a brand new New Yorker, Sean Ono Lennon, spelled S-E-A-N. Okay? Now, tell me, Sean, what's your first impression of New York? I see. As a citizen of the world, Sean, a human being, as it were, who has traveled and lived the world over, what distinguishes New York for you as a place to live and work apart from the world's other major cities? I was wondering if the fiscal crisis of New York had any... that's the one I was talking about, yes. Exactly. Well, what do you think that Mayor Harry is doing about it? You think he's doing a good job? And Governor Bean? I agree entirely, yes. And where did you get that outfit from, may I ask? Knowing that interview is very fashion conscious, I just thought I'd mention it. I see that you're having your diaper changed. Is this an enjoyable experience? Because I do believe some people pay to have this done. No comment, I see. I see you know which subjects to avoid and which not to. That's very sensible. Must be running for office, is that what it is? It is exciting, isn't it? I'm such a strain on the old ticker. Well, now that's over, let's get back to some more serious subjects. Do you have any good cab driver stories about New York? Most New Yorkers seem to have one. No, you don't have any good cab... Have you ever eaten at Elaine's, perhaps? No, you have never eaten at Elaine's. Well, that's too bad. Let me think. You were around for the Thanksgiving Day parade. I was wondering if you'd like to tell me your impressions of that. Is that what you thought of it? Nothing in particular. But don't you remember when Snoopy died outside the window? You don't remember that? I see. Well, I guess it wasn't that important. Oh, he's smiling, folks. Perhaps you'd like to tell me your favorite color. That's not good enough, I'm afraid. No interest in color. You'll be doing any concerts while you're here. Yes, I thought so. You haven't got the group together, I understand completely. I heard that you were backstage at the Dylan concert, or was that just a rumor? An outright lie, my goodness. I was wondering what it's like being the son of such astoundingly famous, beautiful, and talented parents as John and Yoko. I wonder what it's like. Oh, I see. I mean, could you give me yes, more fuller background into that? I see you're very fascinated by this black box that I'm interviewing you with, this tape recorder. In fact, it seems to inhibit you a little. I mean, are you conscious or self-conscious about the tape recorder? Well, he turned his head away because he got very paranoid. It's all right, you know. Just think of it as a very dark relative. Well, perhaps I could change the subject. I was thinking just a short while ago that it may be possible that you'll never get to see Sammy Davis live, or Frank Sinatra for that matter, not to mention Dean Martin. You've missed Jim Croce, we know that. Ah, that got a response. I know. It seems sad that life could be lived without seeing those people, but Elton, what about Elton? He's your godfather. Do you want to tell me how it is to have such a famous godfather? Well, I know he hasn't been to see us yet. That's because he can't come in the country until January. So we just get him on the phone and get his ass over here. Well, I think at that point we left the interviewee because he obviously was getting violent at the thought of not seeing Dean Martin and all those people in their prime, as it were.